Morning, everyone. Great to see you here this morning in the house of the Lord. Welcome to First Baptist Church. Let's have a word of prayer as we begin. Let's stand together. Let's pray. Father God, we praise you for this day, glorious opportunity to come before you and just worship you in spirit and truth. Just pray that you would just anoint Stephen as he brings the word later in our service, Lord God. We just pray for him as our new DOM and just blessed by his presence today. Father, just be with us now. See your son's name we pray. Amen. Remain standing as we sing together. Count your blessings.
Thank you. Thank you. please remain standing as we read from the Word of the Lord this morning. Before I do, I want to take a moment just to say thank you to Brother Stephen for coming this morning. And he is our new Director of Missions for the South Central Baptist area, of which we participate in. And you're going to have a blessing this morning hearing the Word of God through this man. Psalm chapter 24, the King of Glory. The earth and everything in it, the world and its inhabitants, belong to the Lord. For he has laid his foundation on the sea and established it on the rivers. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not appealed to what is false, and who has not sworn deceitfully. He will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who inquire of him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, you gates. Rise up, ancient doors. Then the King of Glory will come in. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Rise up, ancient doors. Then the King of Glory will come in. Who is he, this King of Glory? The Lord of armies. He is the King of Glory. Selah. Let's pray together. Father, we are most grateful for your word that has lasted generation upon generation. It has outlasted every attempt to see its ruin, and it continues to stand as the source of truth for our life, as the foundation upon which our life can be built, because it gives us the foundation of Jesus Christ, the hope of salvation, the glory of our future. Father, we pray this morning as we continue through this time of worship that what you have heard from our lips this morning has come straight from our heart. To worship you is a great honor and a humbling place to be. Father, to come before the throne of grace with confidence because of the blood of Christ being poured out for us on the cross of Calvary. But not ending the story there. The hope of the resurrection, the hope that restores our hope. Father, it is in the hope of that resurrection that we continue to worship even now. We pray this in the resurrected name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And you may be seated.
Thank you. Pray. Lord, we give you thanks for this day. We thank you for the coolness of the morning and just for the beauty that we share as we await the grace of this day. We thank you for this time that we have to come within these walls here known as First Baptist Church. We thank you for the freedom that we have to do so, and we just pray that everything that is said and done here today might be pleasing and uplifting in your name. Lord, we especially ask that you be with Brother Stephen as he comes before us. We pray that you be with him, speak in and through him as he brings your word. We just thank you for bringing him our way here in Gonzales. Lord, we ask now that you be with this portion of the service as we take up the offering. We just ask that you take the gift. We just ask that you take, that you might use it for the ongoing of your kingdom work here in Gonzales and around the world. Just be with us in all that we do today, and we thank you for this time. These things I pray in thy name. No, 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 no,
Good morning. If you've got the Bible, I hope you do. Luke chapter 24 is where we're going. Excited to be here with you this morning. My family has joined you on one other occasion. I was preaching over in Hallettsville, and my family was able to be here, so they'll be here later on in the next service. My name is Stephen Gaither, and I have the honor of serving as the new director of missions for the South Central area of churches. That's two associations, Gonzales, which you guys are a part of, and then Gamble Association. So 54 churches, and they hired a young guy. Spent some time with the XYZs on Thursday, and so that was the question. But we didn't realize a kid was coming in here. And I will tell you what I told them. I am literally the oldest I have ever been. That's all I can do for you. That's all I've got for you. I absolutely love the local church. I love the body of Christ. I'm grateful that there are so many churches and so many communities that have great potential and opportunity to continue to share the hope of Jesus Christ in their community and outside of it throughout all the nations. And I appreciate the support of First Baptist Church Gonzales in that mission to encourage all the surrounding area churches to help equip them as they have needs. And then to engage with the other bodies of Christ that surround you. We can do more together than we can on our own. And sometimes when we're in a struggle, we need to see someone else seeing some gospel impact in their community. And when we're doing well, we need to be able to encourage those who might be having a struggle. So this morning, Luke chapter 24, we're only a couple of weeks past Easter, where we know we celebrate Jesus' death, burial, and most importantly, his resurrection, that he did not stay dead. He didn't just give his life for this cause, but that he actually did what he said he was going to do, and he was raised to new life. So I'm going to do something that might scare you a little bit. We're going to take the entire chapter of Luke 24 and look at it this morning. Now, some of you, if you're used to Dr. Chris over here, you either just got really, really nervous or you got really, really excited. I know you got to be out of here at 9:30, and 9:20 is better, so listen fast, okay? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to walk through this verse by verse. I'm not going to explain each chunk, but we're taking a chunk at a time. I'll throw a couple of key words at you, and I really just want you to ask yourself this question. Have I ever been really amazed at Jesus' story? Have I ever just been really amazed? Have I ever just sat back and thought, this is beyond a Sunday school story, this is beyond something we talk about on Sundays, but that this is an incredible, amazing, life-transforming story. Here's what I believe. I believe the story of Jesus Christ, which I believe is historically accurate and true, I believe that the story of Jesus Christ transforms my story. And he wants to transform my story so that he can use my story to help transform someone else's story. So I get to go from despair to joy, from despair to hope, so that then I can take that joy and I can take that hope and I can share it with someone else who is currently not experiencing joy and is in the middle of despair. So it's not just for me. It's not just so I can go to church and feel better about my day or better about my life or try to make my marriage a little better or pray for my grandkids. Currently don't have any. But it's not just for me and those that are just like me, but it's for all the world. So if you want a title, the title would just be From Despair to Joy, or From Despair to Hope. So the word despair, it's the absence of hope. You ever been in a moment where you're in despair? You get that doctor's report, and they say, we can't cure the cancer. Or you hear some news, and you just despair. Your absence of hope. You have no expectation of something good to come. It just feels like everything comes crashing down. So despair. So you have to think about where we're about to get in Luke chapter 24. These disciples, these individuals who've been following Jesus around, some that had known him from childhood, for at least 3 years, they've been on this public ministry tour with Jesus as he traveled all around and as he did miracles, as he took a blind man and he gave him his sight back, as he took an individual who'd never walked before and he said, take up your mat and walk, and they got up and walked. When he interacted with those who had leprosy and he healed them, even though it meant that whenever they got their leprosy, they couldn't be a part of their family. They couldn't be a part of their community. If they had children, they weren't able to be around them. They weren't able to hug them. They were essentially excommunicated, pushed outside of the community. And when he heals the lepers, they get to see this physical restoration and healing, but they also get to watch this relational healing take place. They got to watch these things, and yes, they got to watch Jesus walk on the water, and if you know the story, they panicked because they thought it was a ghost. And Peter's the only one that gets out of the boat, takes a few steps on the water, and we give him a hard time because he sank. At least he got out of the boat. So you have to put yourself in their shoes of what they had seen, and they had heard about what Jesus was doing, and they watched the tension with the religious leaders. And they understood what it was like to be under the Roman rule. And you could see them navigating through all of this. And then all of a sudden, just when they think things are about to really shift and things are about to change, what happens? Jesus is betrayed by one of the 12. And then he's beaten after he's arrested. He's eventually crucified, hung on that cross, not to die for the wrong that he had done or for the sins that he had done, but we know because there were people that wanted to get him out of the way, but the bigger gospel picture is that God was trying to make a way so that our sins could be forgiven. So Jesus pays that penalty for us, absorbing that wrath of God, and yet they watch their hope hang on a cross. They watch their friend, they watch the one they'd learned to call the Christ, hang on the cross and die. And then he's put into the tomb. And going into Luke chapter 24, there's just this sense of despair, an absence of hope, because Jesus' physical presence with them represented hope for them. We've not had the physical presence of Jesus, but these disciples did. You just have to put yourself in their place. So starting in verse 1 of chapter 24, let's begin to walk through this. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, I like that word perplexed, completely baffled, very puzzled. That was not what they expected. When they went to the tomb, they expected to get some help to roll the stone back and to be able to finish the burial rituals for Jesus. That's their full expectation. They went to the tomb with despair, and they ended up being perplexed, baffled, puzzled at what they were seeing. And about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. Verse 5, and as they were frightened and bowed their heads to the ground, the men said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. I mean, that is an amazing statement of truth, that these women who were perplexed, and before that they were in despair, now all of a sudden they've been given a statement of hope. Remember how he told you? If you have children, have raised children, you've ever been around children, you know this. Didn't we talk about this? Didn't I tell you not to do that? Do you remember whenever we did this? You also know that kids can remember certain things that you would rather forget. I've got three little memory devices that like to remind me when I said this or did that and it didn't work out well. But in this, they have to be reminded. While he was still in Galilee, verse 7, that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise. Verse 8, and they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other woman with them who told these things to the apostles. Verse 11, but these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. So they go back to the disciples. They're perplexed. Now they've got some hope out of that despair. They go back. They tell the disciples. They said, listen, he's not there. We saw an angel, and they were in dazzling apparel. Not just normal apparel. It was dazzling. So we saw them. They told us he's not here. He's been risen. They go back and they said, this feels like a fairy tale to us. It doesn't really seem like you're telling us the truth. And then good old Peter, look what he does. Verse 12, but Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened. The word marveling, filled with wonder or astonishment. So you take all these emotions and these different pieces, despair to perplexed. Then all of a sudden, they're just astonished at what has taken place. I love that it tells us what Peter does. It's action, 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 action from Peter. That's what we know him for, don't we? Peter, you shouldn't have said that. You jumped into action too quick. Peter, why did you chop that man's ear off? If you're going to try to stop someone from arresting Jesus, really you're going for the lobe. Swing and a miss, as we know Peter has a tendency to do. But he's a man of action, and so even here you see it, that he runs and gets to the tomb. Now look what happens. So Peter goes, he sees this as well, and he's just marveling. You know what happens whenever you see something, when you hear something, when you're amazed by something? You talk about it. No one has to tell you, so what happened today? You're talking about it. You're sharing with other people. It's out of you. You want to tell other people. For those of you that have grandchildren, when you get news, or you get a new video, or you get a new picture about what happened recently, you don't wait for someone to ask you about how your grandkids are. With your phone now, you walk in like this. It doesn't matter what's happening. It honestly doesn't even matter who's in the room. You might go to the post office and just stand there and wait, because somebody's coming in there. So when you're amazed or you're excited, you're anticipating something, you just share it. You don't have to be coerced to share it. And that's what happens with the disciples. Now look what happens. Verse 13. This is one of my favorite passages of Scripture. Caveat, I say that just about every time I preach. I'm starting to realize that's a pattern for me. So thankfully, this is one. I really do love it. Verse 13, that very day. What day? It's the same day. This is the same day. This is a continuation of what's happened early in the morning. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. How far? Anybody walk 7 miles this morning? Not on purpose. So 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. So they're marveling, they're still amazed by it, they're talking about it. Verse 15, while they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. Now, did you just catch what happened? If you've been in church too long, you just read that and you don't even worry about it. The dead guy just shows up to the two disciples, two of the disciples that are walking to Emmaus, that are hearing all of this news that there's an empty tomb. Now, they don't realize it's him. Their eyes are covered. Jesus hasn't revealed himself to them. But this is Jesus. This is an appearance right here. If this isn't a living Jesus, we have a real problem. This is either the living Jesus or the Bible just got really weird.
So we know this is the living Jesus. Verse 17, look what he says. And he, this is Jesus, said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" I love this. Jesus shows up. They don't know what's happening. He's like, "What are y'all talking about? What's your conversation about?" And look what happens. And they stood still, looking sad. Feeling or showing sorrow, unhappy, they stood still. They've got a long walk. They've got 7 miles to walk. They've been in despair. Now they're probably pretty confused about what is even happening, what's going on with Jesus. And now they're on a 7-mile walk, and now this guy walks up to them and says, "Well, what are y'all talking about?" And they just stop in their tracks, looking sad. When the Bible says you look sad, that's a pretty good idea. That's a pretty sad moment. There's different ways to walk and get to places. And there's moments like this where you're sad and you're sorrowful and there's despair. Whenever Kristen, my wife, found out that her dad had passed away unexpectedly a few years ago, all that walking and everything that we had to walk through and step into, that was a hard, slow, despairing, sad kind of a walk. Just a hard challenge to walk through. And you guys think that these guys, these disciples, are walking in that way, and now this guy shows up and they just stop everything that they're doing. Verse 18, "Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, 'Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?'" Are you kidding me? Everybody in Jerusalem is talking about this, yet somehow you're the only guy who doesn't understand what has just taken place here. How do you not know what's happened? And then I love Jesus. And he said to them, "What thing?" I find that really funny. And like this ironic kind of a moment. He's like, "Oh, really? Stuff's been going on in Jerusalem?" Well, like what? Like what? Now look the way it says. And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus." Now listen, let's do a little application. In our daily lives, as we're having conversations, if Jesus was to just physically walk up to us in our conversations and he would ask us, "What's talking about?" Would we be able to give the answer, "Oh, you know, the things concerning Jesus"? Or do we have a whole lot of other things to talk about? A lot of the other things we're amazed about, or we're perplexed about, or we're despairing about. What about in the hallways of our churches on a Sunday morning? If Jesus was to walk up and say, "What are y'all talking about?" Like, "Well, we're talking about the pastor." Or, "We're talking about the air conditioner." Or, "We're talking about how such and such isn't here anymore." Or, "We're talking about this." Or, "We're talking about that." Or, "We're despairing about this." Blah, blah, blah. I know I've been guilty of that. I'm pretty sure you probably haven't been. But just in case you ever get a little bit distracted, oh, that our conversations, whether that's in the church building or as the church outside of the building, that our conversations would be concerning Jesus. When we see issues in our communities, in our schools, in our neighborhoods, that we wouldn't just say, "Well, here's what's wrong." That we would say, "How would Jesus respond? What would Jesus do? How could I be like Jesus and represent him well in this community, in this school, in these neighborhoods? How can I do that? What would that look like?" But that's a side note. So concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, verse 20, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified. This is this next statement. Listen to it. But we had hope. Despair, past tense. We had hope. We did have an expectation of something different, of something better. But we really sensed that that's over. We had hoped that Jesus was going to put the Israelites, the nation of Israel, back where it needed to be. That, yeah, maybe the Romans would be kicked out. and we'd be able to worship the one true God, uninhibited. We thought that He would be the one. We thought He was the Christ. We thought He was our Messiah. We thought He was the one that was going to transform our community and our culture so that things could be more of the way we want them to be. But we had hoped that He was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find His body, they came back saying that they had seen a vision of angels who said that He was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but Him they did not see. Now listen to Jesus' words in verse 25. And He said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart. Slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into His glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, He interpreted to them all the scriptures, the things concerning Himself. Verse 28, so they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if He were going farther, but they urged Him strongly, saying, stay with us, for it is toward evening. What is it toward? Evening. This started early in the morning at the empty tomb. They took off in the afternoon, and now it's towards evening. And the day is now far spent. So He went in to stay with them. When He was at table with them, He took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. That just reminds me of that Passover feast they would have had when Jesus institutes the Lord's Supper on the night of His betrayal. You're going to tell me that these disciples sitting there all of a sudden aren't starting to go like, you know who He reminds me of? Kind of getting that like, wait a second, what's going on here? Verse 31, and their eyes were opened and they recognized Him. And He vanished from their sight. Where'd He go? It's Him! That's Jesus! All of a sudden, infused with hope, from despair to this joy and this hope, and then gone. That's just mean of Jesus. He should have at least talked to a few people, asked them about their grandkids, see how they were doing. But He just vanishes. He gives them this hope, and then He's gone. Now look at their response here. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while He talked to us on the road, while He opened to us the scriptures? Suppose that same hour. Wait a second. Isn't the day far spent? Hasn't this been a pretty long day? Talk about a long, challenging weekend. And they say, you know what? They told Jesus, not knowing it was Him, you need to stay. Hey, it's getting dark outside. The roads get a little bit dangerous. This is when a lot of bad things happen. It's not like they have street lights. And watch what happens. And they rode that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. Do you remember how far of a walk that is? 7 miles. So they're putting in at least 14 miles in one day. Not in a car, not in an air-conditioned buggy. I mean, just walking. Now, do you think they went back to Jerusalem the same way they were going to Emmaus? No, they were carrying the weight of despair and sorrow and sadness as they walked to Emmaus. So just like my wife and I, you kind of walk through the mud. You just kind of trudge through whenever someone you love and care about is no longer able to be physically present with you and they pass away. But our family's been in the international adoption process for 2 years and 4 months, but we're not counting. And so in February, our little boy in Haiti had a birthday, and I was able to go and visit him. I mean, it was a quick trip, 12 hours there, 12 to 14 hours back in 2 days, actually, in Haiti. But I got there, it was already dark, the day was far spent, and so was my energy. But when I got to the orphanage, and there's not many lights there, and I could pull out my phone and turn on my flashlight, and I was trying to video as best I could, And then I began to walk in, and all the little toddlers are kind of in the first little rooms, and they start yelling, "Papa Rubinho, Papa Rubinho!" A little boy, they call him Rubinho in the orphanage. That's not his name. His name's Judy. But they start saying, "Papa Rubinho, Papa Rubinho," because I've been there a couple of times. And then another little girl comes and runs beside me and, like, grabs my hand, and so she's starting to move. And I go, "Where is he? Where is he?" And I knew he would be in the back towards where the older boys stay, a little bit further back. And so I knew he was going to be back there, and so I walk alongside, and it's all dark. And so when we're coming out there, and "Papa Rubinho, Papa Rubinho," and we're walking and walking, there's an anticipation. And so as soon as I get around the corner and then he sees me, he books it over there, and I go to him, and there's a great embrace. Now, that's a different type of walk, isn't it? There's hope, there's anticipation, there's some fulfillment. It's not despair and sorrow and sadness dropping him off back at the orphanage after a couple of days and getting back on the plane and coming back. That's a different type of walk, too. But that's the kind of, in my mind, that's the kind of anticipation and walk and excitement that they went back to Jerusalem with. Now, look what unfolds. "Now they rode that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together," verse 34, "saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread." Now, they get back to Jerusalem. It's way late by this point. They get to the disciples who are scared and they're still in despair. They don't know what's happening. And then they show up and they say, "Hey, Jesus really has risen. He showed up with us and he talked to us on the road. We saw him. And then he broke the bread and we realized who it was. He's alive." Now, what's the question from the group? "Well, where is he?" "We have no idea. He vanished." "Okay. Get you some Gatorade. You're probably a little dehydrated. Come sit down here for a minute. Y'all get him something. It's been a long, difficult weekend for everybody." Now look what happens. As they were talking about these things, the things concerning Jesus, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands, my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy, not sorrow, for joy, and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate before them. That's how you know Jesus was probably a Baptist. Because if it's going to be a real meeting, you're going to be eating. Verse 44, "Then he said to them, 'These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled.' Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, 'Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with the power from on high.'" He's referencing the Holy Spirit. "For the Holy Spirit would come and indwell them and indwell every believer that has come since." Verse 50, "And he led them out as far as Bethany and lifted up his hands. He blessed them. While he blessed them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven, and they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great," what's the word? "Joy. And were continually in the temple blessing God." Jesus' story transforms my story, your story. So that then our story that's been transformed can be used to transform somebody else's story. Now that can be, you can talk all kinds of really spiritual, highbrow type of things that means, and theology and doctrine, and that's all really, really important. But it also has to land very practically in the neighborhood that you live in the school that your children or grandchildren go, in the places that you drive by. Every time you walk into Walmart and HEB, every time that we do anything that we do, if we will be living a life that's gone from despair to joy, then guess what? We'll be amazed at who Jesus is, what he's done in our lives, and we'll want him to do amazing things in the lives around us. And you know what? Sometimes that's as simple as connecting with somebody who has a child that struggles to read and investing some time helping them to learn to read. Because you know what? If I would have never learned to read, I couldn't have read all that to you. And I couldn't have studied that and experienced that. There are so many practical ways for the body of Christ, individual believers in this place and all over the place, to have an impact in their communities beyond what happens on a Sunday morning. And Jesus says this, if you want to go from despair to hope, from hurt to healing, to sadness to joy, then it's about repentance for the forgiveness of your sins, that Jesus died to cleanse you and make you new. And then he says we're to go and proclaim with our lives, our actions and our words, in word and deed, the joy of Jesus, and be sharing that with others. And we know this, that when we stand amazed in the presence of Jesus Christ, we'll be in awe of who he is. We'll be amazed that he would be willing to forgive us and use our lives for good. And we can be people that can help people go from despair to hope. My prayer is that each of us will take that serious, that we'll live lives concerning Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father God, we're grateful for this opportunity this morning to gather together. We're grateful for the kingdom impact that this church is making. And Lord, we know that as long as we have breath in our lungs, that we have a responsibility to share hope with others. And that can come in a lot of practical ways. But the core heart of it has to be understanding who Jesus is and what he has done for us, so that we'll be willing to lay down our lives to help others. Lord, maybe there's someone in this room that's never given their life to Jesus Christ. They've got that weight and that burden of sin upon them. God, may today be a day where they would say, man, I confess that I'm a sinner, that I've fallen way short of what God has desired. And I am in desperate need of forgiveness. I need a Savior. I need to be forgiven. I want to be made new. God, maybe others just say, you know what, I've just been kind of hesitating on taking that next step of faith and I've given my life to Christ, but I've never walked through a believer's baptism, and I'm ready to do that. I'm ready to be identified as a follower of Christ. God, maybe for those of us who are believers in Jesus Christ, we've been baptized, we've sung the hymns, we've gone to so many different Bible studies and events, and we know about church life and what that looks like and the struggles and the joys. But God, maybe we've just slipped a little bit more into despair than we have hope. Lord, I pray that you would stir in us, that our hearts would burn as we read the scriptures and see the beauty of Jesus Christ, and that our hearts would burn and ache as we look into our communities and see that there is a desperate need for hope. And it can start with that little boy across the street, or that single mom that lives down the road, or those individuals that we run into in our daily routines. Lord, that we would see the needs of people and be able to help meet those needs with the hope concerning Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Pastor Chris is going to come. We're going to stand, have a time of invitation. If you need to pray, don't hesitate.
Jesus, keep me in the
core. First Baptist Gonzales, and worshiping with us this morning. I want you to remember that you're loved first and foremost by Jesus Christ. He gave his life for you on the cross, and it is a life-changing choice to believe in him, to call on his name. The Bible says that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved in Romans 10:13. I want to urge you to call on him today. If you have already made Jesus your Savior and Lord, maybe this morning as a result of the service, would you do us a favor and call here at the church, 672-9595. Let us know of your choice, and we want to celebrate with you. We'd also like to pray for you. You could call the church office again or send us an email or write us a letter and let us know how our prayer ministry could lift you and your family up to our Heavenly Father who cares about you and your family. Thanks again for watching. We pray that you enjoy our service, that you're able to worship along with us, and we'll see you here next time on TV 17. God bless.